To Academy of Tone 118, with a summer vibe, Kai Sonnhalter and Some Things Got Me Started.
Not particularly a rock song.
But hey, yeah, it's fun to do different things. Oh, I see my setup is falling apart. Today we have a very sophisticated setup. I remember, I think it was Osmium Studios or some guys that are in the chat here more regularly asking on how can I do a setup with the AMP1 Mercury and Iridium in stereo. And I didn't answer it back then in the episode, but that it made me thought again. And I thought, okay, let's do the proper thing. And what would I personally do if I had that kind of setup? I'm still on mono myself.
Me too. Yeah. I did this actually. This is my.
This is Kai's board.
My
here.
Board with a one AMP1 Mercury Edition. Yeah. One power amp mono.
Yeah, and I kind of beefed it up to a stereo. So here we have the Iridium next to it, and we're using his MS3, the Boss MS3, for all the switching and the effects, but in stereo. And then we're also using all the different preamps. So here I have the AMP1 Mercury Edition clean channel. Here I have the Iridium Edition clean channel. This is the vintage channel of the Mercury. This is the vintage channel of the Iridium. And this is a good example to show you again the difference between Mercury and Iridium, mm-hmm. which is another question that we have daily.
True.
So maybe I show you the sound first and then I explain the whole setup, because the setup is the seven cable method, which is next level. I think it goes up even to 10 cables in the end, but it's...
Yeah, it's if you include MIDI, it's even 11.
Okay, this one goes to 11.
Yeah, this
okay. Okay. Just sound-wise, what I'm doing here, I'm using a stereo delay, so if you have stereo at home, you can hear... There's kind of a ping-pong thing going on. The reverb comes from the AMP1. Okay. And this is like the clean of the Mercury. Okay, I switch to the Iridium. Back to the Mercury. So now you have to decide which one you like better.
I expected a bigger difference between the two.
Well, I try to set them up in a way that I can use them with one guitar.
Okay, there you go.
And this is now the Strat or the Les Paul, like classic guitars. But it is a similar setup, actually. So the volume is similar, the boost is engaged on both, and similar setup there. And the tone, both clean tones are all the way up. So I was kind of striving for sparkle. Okay, forgive me for the delay, but this is part of the stereo thing. Okay, anyway, so Mercury, Iridium, and now we go for the vintage channel on the Mercury. Iridium.
Here is we have different patches, as they call it in the MS3, which all have the stereo delay, because right. We want to show the stereo setup, and it helps us to detect the stereo setup.
Right.
And we have the stereo delay on all the patches that we're checking out now.
Yeah.
So
yeah. But now you can hear the difference between the Mercury, which is kind of this low end,
yeah,
and then the a lot tighter Iridium. Okay, and then I go bank up. First one is classic channel. Okay, yeah, I use the gate on both. Okay. And then classic on Iridium. Again, Iridium tighter, more aggressive.
Yeah, a lot tighter, yeah.
So, and then on three, I have the modern of the Mercury. And on four, I have the Iridium. To make it even More obvious, I use a humbucker guitar.
Yeah, a lot more aggressive than the Mercury.
Yeah, so here is your decision, you know? This is like... Oops, this is modern, okay. Backwards, we are on classic on the Iridium. And classic on the Mercury. Cuts through with the humbuckers. Okay, and then let's go down on bank four, and this is vintage on the Iridium with a list. Vintage on the Iridium to me is instant Van Halen.
Yeah.
To me.
Yeah, it is.
Old school Van Halen. Yeah. I love that tone. Okay, back to the Mercury vintage.
There's one interesting thing going on now, because since we have a stereo setup, we're using two different power amplifiers.
Mm-hmm.
We're using the power amp of the Mercury Edition on one side and the power amp of the Iridium Edition on the other side.
Yeah.
So in that stereo picture, you might even be able to detect differences between left and right.
Absolutely.
And my question would be, from there you go to two separate blue boxes?
With the same setting.
With the same setting. That would have been my question.
Yeah, I tried... If I didn't do any mistakes, I'm on stack 1970 with the same mic precision. And yours is a bit dusty.
Yeah, that's... it's not only my blue box is dusty. Yeah.
Low gain mode on this one as well, right? Did you play yours? I didn't change anything.
Yeah, then it is.
Okay, so this is again a little bit less gain than the Iridium because it's on low gain and I put it on 7.2, but you still hear the character. It's two different amps. Iridium Mercury. And the same now with clean. that's the Mercury clean. In the end, I would say the Mercury is more polite and the Iridium is more in your face and more aggressive. Yeah. Well, okay, but this is how it is. This is also why we have the different amps. And of course, from this, you can even tweak each of the amps towards different tastes and tones. But so this was the section how to compare the things, the two amps with the same setup. And how this is done, because this is kind of magic. I'm just hitting one button here and I'm on this amp now and I'm on this amp now. To be able to switch between the two amps, we are using the seven cable method. Seven, and, you know, everybody is familiar maybe with the four cable method. Let's start with the one cable method. If you have a guitar cable, plug it into an amp, switch it on, that's one cable. Okay, the four cable method is when you plug into a multi-effects unit and use a send into the amp, cable number two, and then the return back into the multi-effects unit for the post effects, and then the output of that going back into the power amp of your amp. That makes four cables. And to be able to switch two amps, we need another three cables, which are these. I hope you can see. Well, basically all we need an input to the amp, we need a send and a return. The return is coming from the stereo out of our multi-effect device, and the signal feed is coming from the loop. And this goes back into the loop. So to be able to switch both units, we need two loops. And you have the option to engage one loop or the other loop. If the first loop is on, we will hear the amp that is in the first loop, which is in our case the Mercury Edition. Yep. And if the second loop is on, we switch off the first loop and switch on the second loop, and this Iridium Edition is coming on.
I'm not sure if you guys can see this in the in the picture you're seeing actually right now,
yeah.
But the MS3 indicates which loop is active with these little LEDs. I'm not sure if you can see it. I'm switching between the two now. Now loop one is active, and now loop two is active, so you can see it here. And the same with all the other sounds. So the first one is always loop one, the second one is always loop two. You can see it here.
Yeah, it's this little, how to show, okay. This is the red
loop
dot.
One, loop two.
Okay, it switched between, it's very little LED here. But, okay, we have a little diagram that shows the seven cable method. Let's see that thing. Okay. So the first cable is the guitar that goes into the input of the MS3 in this case. Then when you look at loop one, we didn't use an amp there because the MS3 offers three loops. And we thought, okay, have a pedal in a loop that you can still program with your patch or your preset, whatever it's called.
I could have done that with my with the EP booster that I have on my board here, but I decided not to do it. I put it like
master
physically in front of everything so I can switch it on and off whenever I want.
Yeah.
But that's something that you could put in loop one and switch it on and off with your patch.
Yeah. So back to the diagram. So the two yellow cables and this pedal would be a pedal pre the amps. So that is an option with this unit. We also have...
Now that I look at it, I did this this afternoon, and now that I look at it, it's actually wrong because most pedals have the input on the right.
Yeah, okay. But it looks cool. Since we don't know the pedal, Kai has created a pedal that has the input on the left and the output on the right.
Exactly.
I think it's okay. So yeah. you get a picture. There is a send and a return.
Yeah, in the real world, the whole thing, well, the MS3 would be the other way around because now we're looking at it from the back.
Back, yeah.
But if you're using it and you look at it from the top, then the send is on the right side. So and everything works again.
It works. It works. So Boss is not that stupid. They thought of that and they did it the right way. It's just our diagram that is kind of flipped around. But anyway, so this is the loop one. That is an option on the MS3. We also have an HX effects here in behind Kai on this little board here. And the Line 6's HX effects offers two loops. And these two loops would be enough to switch between the Mercury and the Iridium. So, yeah.
That's one thing that we should mention in general. The MS3 is not the only device that you can create the setup with.
Yeah.
There's lots of other devices on the market, amongst others, the HFX by Line 6.
Yeah. Okay, back to the diagram. So now we are on the first loop where we see the orange cables, which in this case is loop 2. And there's a send going to the input of the Mercury Edition. And there is the send of the effects loop on the Mercury Edition that goes back to the return of the loop 2.
And this is actually, so far, this is the 4-cable method.
Yeah.
So what happens is you plug your guitar into the input of the effects device. It goes through all the pre-effects in the effects device, then hits the first loop, goes out to the input of the amp, goes through the preamp of the amp and takes the effects send to go back into the effects unit.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and now to switch between the Mercury and the Iridium, we need to have the Iridium in the next loop. In our case, it's loop number 3. And it's the same setup. There's a send that goes to the input and there's a return that goes to the effects send of the Iridium. So this is the connection here. And the loops are switching both preamps. We are switching from the Mercury preamp in loop 2 to the Iridium preamp in loop 3.
Yeah.
And mind not to use both preamps because this would be too much of everything. Too much noise, too much gain, too much hiss, too much... It's either one of the two loops that should be active.
So what you need to know in this case is that these three loops, and I'm not sure if this is the same with other devices, but they are in a row. You cannot change
the order. They're serial.
They're serial. I think you can change them in the whole effects signal path order, but always only in total, the three of them. You cannot just move one of them, but they're always together. And so
I tell you why, because they are analog.
Exactly.
And this is the thing when we talk about our MX, which is here, analog, the routing or the order of effects in the analog world is more or less fixed. In the digital world, you can do tons of stuff. It's in the analog world, you literally have to have cables coming from here to there, and it doesn't make any sense to flip those around endlessly. That's the way it is, and this is something you have to get used to when you have an MPX. There's a lot possible, but not everything. We are back on our 7-cable method here.
So these three loops are always in the same order.
Yep.
And you can move them around, but what you can do, of course, is switch them on and off separately, individually.
Yeah.
And that is important because, as I mentioned before, we don't want both preamps at the same time because it would sound pretty ugly.
Yeah. Okay. And then when we are post these loops, we have again the stereo effects coming from, in this case, the Boss MS3. And there is a stereo output, which are these two guys here. Here's output. You can't see from the top.
Maybe we can show the diagram again. You can see it there.
and which are the blue one, the dark blue cables. And these, it's left and right, they go back to the effect returns. One side goes to the Mercury Edition, effects loop return of the Mercury Edition, and the other side goes to the Iridium Edition effects return. And this is the setup we've done here.
And from there, that's something that's not in the diagram. Of course, we go to either a blue box or a guitar cabinet, or we use the rec out of of the units, and you know.
And that's a stereo signal.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess this was the audio side of the most advanced 2-amp stereo 8 preamps setup. So, and now we're talking about this mess here. That's my homemade MIDI splitter device, because the MS3 has a MIDI out, which is beautiful. And when I had Kai's board, he uses a proper MIDI cable going to the MIDI 1 adapter. And the MIDI 1 adapter is going into this socket of the, into the switching socket of the Mercury Edition. And so he can switch channels and boost and reverb and all the functionalities via MIDI coming from the MS3. Okay, with two units, we have a problem because there's only one MIDI out and there's a MIDI cable that goes into an adapter and how to connect the second unit. And there are some options. You can buy MIDI splitters in the internet. There's a thing that we found. This is some adapter cables that you could buy, but you know, it was no time for me to buy, so I did it myself. Or there's even like MIDI splitter boxes, Keytron or whatever, Kenton, whatever, UK brand. They have even 5 MIDI outs or 5 MIDI throughs. So what these boxes or cables are doing, they're just duplicating the MIDI signal. And first I tried to do it the dirty way and have the MIDI 1 adapter, this one I killed purposely, and got the quarter inch jack and made a parallel quarter inch connection to the next amp, but that doesn't work. This is the internal stuff that you can see inside the MIDI 1 adapter. Can we show that? Because actually, see, inside our little MIDI 1 adapter, there's an optocoupler and a couple of components. Okay, it's actually a MIDI interface inside the plug. And this MIDI interface is not sensitive, which means if I connect the two pins of the MIDI, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 2 and 4, in parallel with another one, it simply works. So that's what I've done with my Drahtverhau wires. I simply had the two wires coming from the MIDI out of the MS3, put it to this, and then having in parallel another MIDI cable. So I just split.
And that MIDI cable is connected to another MIDI one interface.
Yeah,
that's so important. So we need two MIDI ones
to get this setup working. And that's possible because this kind of optocoupler is not sensitive. So it's kind of, the MIDI drives enough signal for two MIDI one adapters. What simply works. And the result,
which you just found out the other day. We didn't know that before.
No. You know, this is learning by doing. And you can either do it yourself. We have, by the way, a little article now on the knowledge base.
Yes.
How to make that cable, or how, what cable to buy. So that the cable that you have seen here, it's something you can also buy. Or this kind of MIDI splitter. Yeah, and that's the way how to switch amps. See? This, it's magic. I press the MS3 and the amps are switching. And both amps are switching. So that's the magic. One MIDI out controls two units.
Yeah. Until last week, I mean, I knew that this was possible with the Remote One, because the remote one has a MIDI out.
Yeah, where's my Remote One?
Maybe. Can't see it anywhere.
Here it is.
Yeah. So you can control two amp ones with this one, because the first one is just controlled via the regular
quarter inch jack connected to one amp one, and the MIDI out would then drive a MIDI one adapter and switch the other amp one. Yeah. In this case,
you wouldn't have any effects. This thing does not only do the MIDI job, but it also delivers effects.
Yeah, we could do the same setup like this, but we could also have a setup that switches two amp ones and switches between the two amp ones when using the remote one with our looper kit, because the looper kit offers four loops. Mm-hmm. So we could have like the two amp ones in loop three and four, and would have two extra pedals to go in front of them and program them with the programs of the remote one.
So, and we would be all analog in this case.
And yeah, and this is the esoteric high-end solution that could be done in this case. So as you can see, there are many, many options. That's also a neat setup. I started to build a pedal board with that, but I'm too busy to finish everything. But I tried it and it works. That was the main issue. I just put an amp there, plugged it in, programmed, and it worked. So, proof of concept done.
Perfect.
I
just saw a question. Yeah. I mean, it's half answered already. The question was that somebody who was thinking about buying the MS3 asking, how exactly did I set this up? And Thomas, I mean, actually explained it already. I did it using the four cable method. Mm-hmm. So the EP booster is the only thing that's really in front of everything. And from there, I'm going to I can't see it now. I think it's over there. The input of the MS3. Mm-hmm. I'm using only one loop to connect the preamp of the AMP1. Going to the input of the AMP1 from the effects send back into the MS3. And then from the output of the MS3 into the effects return of the amp. And that's basically it. And of course, and that was another question, of course you need the MIDI one adapter, because the four cable method is only responsible for the signal chain, so for what you hear, but for switching, you need MIDI so that you can control the AMP1 using the MS3.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I hope this explains that kind of most versatile setup possible with AMP1s. Little side comment here. The other day I did a comparison with like two Mercuries versus a Mercury and an Iridium. We told you before that the power amp of the two amps are sounding different due to the sound design. And what happened is you get a different frequency on each side. And first you think, maybe it's not good. But Uli Brodersen was in the office the other day, And he came up with the idea, he has the Iridium and he loves the Iridium for his fast, funky and whatever he's doing, fusion stuff. I did him a lot of low gain stuff to get him out of the metal zone, and he really likes it with the classic tones. And then we experimented with like two Iridiums, and then at a certain point we throw in a Mercury and the whole sound spectrum got wider because of the two colors of the two amps in the power amp section. Mm-hmm. So this was, he ended up having both amps now, using mainly the Iridium preamp because that's kind of his thing. But for the power amps, he, and I actually agree, I like the mixture of the two. It sounded killer. I mean, he will use that setup in the near future, but from what I heard in the office when we tried it out, it was very three-dimensional. You know, everything was kind of, it was like, boom, different, bigger, and not too much in any way. It wasn't, it was just better.
Yeah. Do you think it would make a bigger difference than using two of the same amps and then different IRs or different guitar cabinets? Because that would be another option. It would be interesting what that sounds like.
Well, both of these options do a similar thing. They kind of give you a different frequency range for each side.
Yeah.
And that seems to be a good thing. I'm not the stereo expert here, so this is why I'm kind of fresh and new to this thing with the different speakers. I know how to blend different speakers. We've done this in the past with Jason Kettner when something didn't sound good enough. I can name the product. It was called Zenamp. And this amp was okay, but you know, it was like a modeling amp and something was missing. And then we came up with the idea of mixing two speakers, putting them in the housing. One is like a vintage 30 and the other one was like a greenback. And again, that combination of the two speakers made the whole amp sounding more alive. Mm-hmm. So I'm familiar with the concept of mixing two speakers to get a more alive tone. In this case, yeah, it's two power amps that did the job as well. Anyway, it's the message is, don't think it's bad. Give it a try. Mm-hmm. I was positive. I was excited. Very positive. Made me think. Okay, do we have any questions on this tech nerd subject? I see people are more into simple stuff here. What is this? Ich bin so zufrieden mit dem Mercury, dass ich nie mehr wechseln werde. Okay. Das ist no comment. Somebody is happy with the Mercury.
He will, ich kann den Mercury und den ersten, der Amp der ersten Generation nicht unterscheiden. So that's somebody asking the difference between the AMP1 Mercury Edition and the first AMP1 that it's somebody started calling Silver, the Silver Edition.
Because now we're calling it, there is no Mercury sign here. So there was no name, and everybody calls it now the Silver Edition. And
there's an article on BluGuitar on every single difference there is.
Yeah.
You know, there's some optical differences.
There's
of course, reverb. There are some tonal differences.
Yeah. Here, another story. The other day, we had a local Fender player coming to us with his 64 Blackface Super Reverb. Mm-hmm. And I do have exactly the same year in Super Reverb. So we put them both in the AB switching system, and then we switched AB about the Super Reverbs, and we found out, fuck, they sound really identical, which is not so usual with mm-hmm. old amps. And Fender is not as critical with Marshall. Any old Marshall sounds different, even the same year. It's there's no consistency. But with the Fender amps, they were very, very, very similar. Mm-hmm. So, and his problem was his super reverb dies so many times when he plays live, tubes failure and stuff. So he always has another Fender amp as a backup with him.
Okay.
And then I said, you know what? This is a small little 1.5 kilogram thing that could do the job for you. And what we've done is we put that in the switching system on loop number 3, and we could switch between my super reverb, his super reverb, and then the silver edition. And on loop number 4, we had the Mercury edition. And guess what? The silver edition was the closest to the super reverbs. And I tell you why, because it has a fluffier low end. Everybody hates it, but this is this is the authentic vintage quality. Only available in silver edition, discontinued. If you have one of those,
keep it and sell it for a lot of money in many years.
Yeah, because this is the blackface tone. There it is. It is there. It's proven. Maybe we do an episode about this one day. But it is. Mercury is close, but this is closer. It's unbelievable. You know, when I did the first one, I was in my vintage world, as you know, it's all old stuff here. And the silver edition has this nice Fendery, fluffy low end on the clean side. If you don't hear the difference, good for you, because you don't have to worry. I'm just telling the talks of nerds coming to this studio, spending one day dialing in the same numbers on amps. Okay, we put this on 6, on 6, on 6. We put this on 5, 5. And we switch, okay, is the volume equally? And then you play, I play, difference, maybe not. So, no? And then bring in these amps, and this is his replacement for the Super Reverb now. Makes his life easier. He's a blues guy, he needs to be with the Fender on stage. Fair enough, no problem, you know.
He needs it for the mojo.
Yeah, there's a mojo. Fair enough. Yeah, and the four trends of the Super Reverb, they sound killer. And by the way, we compared them as well. And the mine are the black 410 in the blue box. So if you want to get that tone, you have to switch to the black 410. And then you use one of our clean channels and you get your Super Reverb. Get a silver one and a M1 silver, and you are even closer to the real deal. Okay, but the question again, what is the difference? There are a few videos out there. I have done one with Andreas Kloppmann, who is another tone hunter, tone nerd.
There's actually a whole AOT episode.
Yeah.
And it's AOT 75. I don't know if that's correct, but...
Yeah.
There's a whole episode on that topic.
Yeah. And if you don't hear the difference, good for you. I mean, we're talking about little differences. Sometimes they mean the world, because this is why people pay crazy money for vintage gear and guitars, because they believe there is a difference. Well, is it important? It is important only if you think it's important. If you don't hear the difference, hey, you can be happy, because the audience will listen to the happiness factor of the player and not the gear.
Very true.
Yeah.
Very true.
So.
Yeah, it's, yeah. It's, when you play live, it's all about being comfortable with your own tone.
Yeah,
and have a sound and a tone that inspires you
and
to play.
And no, if that matter happens, what it is,
so absolutely.
So that's the point, you know.
That's actually that's one of the reasons why these two things make me happy on stage. When the Iridium came out and I used the combination of the Iridium and the Blue Box, it made me feel a lot better on stage, because. I play in a lot of bands where I do.
No. You mean the Mercury?
Yeah. What did I say?
Iridium.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Correct.
I mean the Mercury. Sorry.
Yeah. Because I played the silver at the beginning as well.
Yeah.
And then and the Mercury was your thing.
I like the sound of the Mercury better, because that fluffiness that you mentioned is a little bit too much for me. But I do a lot of in-ear when I play live, because I also sing, and for singing, you know, in-ear is the best. It's just the best. But it has never been good for me as a guitar player. Mm-hmm. And when the Blue Box came out, my sound on my in-ear monitors changed dramatically. And it made me a better player just because I felt more comfortable on stage. Before that, I hit a note and was like, I don't like the way that sounds. And I just didn't want to, go on playing.
Yeah.
And with this one, it was like, oh, that sounds good. Maybe I play another note.
Yeah. And maybe you play another note, and then you play faster, and then you play more, and then you do it. Okay, so we have another little topic prepared for today. As Kai is here, we worked a little bit more on our sound finder the other day. And we want to show you that this is kind of a, ever-growing platform. And if you have any questions, of course, we can see them in the stream. We see them on all the social media sites. But there's our knowledge base, BluGuitar.com. And every day or every week, we put out new articles on this platform. Why? Because we have new questions or new ways how to describe things. So you can understand solutions for whatever topics or issues or problems you have, or get inspired. And one thing that was asked a lot is the tone finder or sound finder. And here's a little story that I have to tell you, because the other day, the episode I've done on Santana, it was like 2 weeks ago. I started with Santana's Black Magic Woman on the Mercury Edition and so on. And guess what? Here's a thing you should never do, because this was a mistake that I've done. I play Black Magic Woman once in a while. I never played it note by note, but I have my way of playing Black Magic Woman, mm-hmm. just from what's in my mind. So what happened when I've done the live stream, I thought, okay, let's get the Les Paul, let's be more accurate, let's listen to the sounds, let's dial it in. And then I found out, oh, Carlos does a different bending pattern. I'm not sure if this was my pattern or his, but it is definitely different. He makes a, he bends the one note where I hit the note, and then I bend it afterwards. So it was the other way around. And what happened in that stream, and this is what I will never do, is like, okay, I learned the proper way before it. And then when I was playing the stream, I was fucking up that note, the most important note in that whole song. And I fucked it up so badly that I thought, I would never do that if I would think about, or don't think about it, if I simply would play it. But this was something.
So it happened because you noticed in advance, okay, he does it differently, and then you started thinking about it, and you wanted to do it the right way instead of the way you've been doing it all these years.
Exactly. So while I was playing, my brain was kind of frozen, couldn't decide to play that note or bend that note. So there's like a moment of complete mess. And if you, maybe you don't notice, which is good on you, but I hated it. So this thing I fixed, and this is now on the sound finder. Let's have a quick listen to this without the bad note. It's Carlos Santana from the Abraxas album, Black Magic Woman, a good example. Kai is looking for it. Ah, wait a minute, I give you the sound. We have to use this cable.
Is it muted?
It's muted, yeah. I'm well prepared.
Okay,
wait a minute. Just a quick fix, and here we go, hopefully.
Depending on the internet connection.
Maybe the internet is not...
Should be okay.
Coming?
Nothing's happening. I'm gonna reload the page.
Yeah.
Although I don't.
Okay, anyway, so this is this was the fix on the very important So now we can listen to that in a nicer way on the sound finder. What is new on the sound finder? Do we have
We have like one or two more guitar players. Well, or actually, I think we have some updated videos. Mm-hmm. Santana being one of them. Mm-hmm. And what I'm working on right now, I have a little something new, but there's going to be even more in the future. You see, this is the German version because I always have to start on the German page, and then I have to transfer it to the English one. If you have ever clicked on instead of looking browsing by guitar player browsing by amp model, you will have noticed that we only had 3 amps, I think, on the page, and it's not many more. It's 6 now.
Yeah,
but there will be a lot more in the next couple of days.
Well, it is categories. I mean, we are talking about 5150 and Victor Kraken metal amps and stuff like that, but. So there are examples for like 5150s, and there are examples for those.
And we also have like some more videos on certain sounds, so you can see that they actually work. So in this case, this is the bassman. We do not only have an A-B comparison, but we also have some videos.
About the original amp.
About who plays the amp.
Yeah.
And which sounds can be realized with them. Yeah. So that's new on the sound finder.
And of course, you know, there's certain people who play many amps. Steve Ray Vaughan plays Super Reverb, but he plays also basements. He played 100 watt Marshalls as well. I've been there. I heard how loud that was. And you know, so certain players had more than one amp. And of course, for us, sometimes it's hard to define exactly what tone you want. And sometimes we get it, and sometimes we have one. So if you look at the sound finder, if you have, well, any other requests, let us know, because then we know what to do in the future.
Yeah, and by the way, we also put the topic that we talked about earlier today, the 7 cable method.
Ah, can you put it on the screen so we show the guys? Okay, so this is...
So that's the name of the article, MIDI-controlled stereo AMP1 system using the 7 cable method. And we go through it all. You know, what's the requirement? In this case, we need a loop switching system with at least 2 loops. There's one by Boss, there's others by Line 6 or other companies. And then we go through the connection and the signal routing, what exactly you need to do step by step, and then how you program the system. You know, what we mentioned before, always only use one, make sure you always use only one loop. So how that is done, how MIDI works with the AMP1, the MIDI setup, including the adapter that you soldered yourself.
Hand wired.
Yes. and then in the end, the whole programming with the diagram that we've seen before, with the 7 + 3 cables in this case.
Yeah. Okay. I see a few questions or comments here. Somebody, David Matai, is going double door amp cases. For me, this is back in the 1990s. I still have my double door rack system in the next room over here. I believe this is a way how you can do things, but for me it's the past. I think the modern pedal board like this is already advanced. Why? Because in the rack era you had to have 19 inch kind of a standard size for the units, then you could mount them all in this case. And then you have to have a foot controller that goes with it, and therefore you need a big snake that controls all that stuff, which gives you an extra pedal board that you have in front of you to have access to your sounds that coming from the rack system. And then inside the rack system, all the units, they are kind of heavy because they're in solid heavy steel enclosures with the rack ears. We call it rack ohren. I don't know what's the English word, but
I know either.
for mounting there, and that's heavy, and so you end up with a heavy box. I'm personally happy that these days are over. If you want to go for that and have your own fridge, this is back the fridge.
Well, you need to have the right car for that.
Yeah. So just thinking about a pedal board these days, you have everything on the pedal board. Everything is already directly accessible. The signal path is very compact, short, cables.
And the whole rack system is in this
one
case.
And when you travel with this, it's so much easier than having 19 inch plus the depth plus the weight. It's no fun, and you get the same performance in that new pedal board format. So for me, pedal board is a thing why I understand why pedal boards became popular after rack systems. So this is my answer. And then of course the next level is having all your pedal board into this machine. But this is the future. Not talking too much about this today.
Something that I noticed, because and you are the same way, I made so much effort over the last couple of years to have my equipment smaller, more lightweight, so it doesn't take me hours, to set it up. And to break it down again, and I'm finally there now with a solution that I'm pretty happy with, and it's getting better. Looking at this thing there, but there's a downside too, because you do this because you think you don't have to carry that much heavy stuff around anymore. Mm-hmm. So now that I have this, mm-hmm. and I'm done setting up my own stuff within 1 minute, I spent half the evening carrying the drummer stuff around.
Yeah. Well, and then, that's the problem. I mean, the bass players now learn to get lightweight gear as well, but the drummers are still a pain in the ass. And but most of the drummers also downsized a little bit over the years. I remember the days when they had like 8 toms and whatever, this many floor
toms. The classical Manny von Bohr setup.
Yeah, the Manny von Bohr. Well, I mean, he still lives that thing, which is fair enough for Manny von Bohr, but, and I love him for doing that, but most of the other drummers I play with is these days, you know, they have like the padded, it's not a case for the drums, you know, the what is it, sleeves or
it's like a soft gig bag.
Yeah, like gig bags for the drum. Way lighter, way easier to transport. The biggest shit is the hardware case with the cymbal stands. I mean, but they need to be heavy, otherwise the cymbals will fly around. Yeah, but at least we can improve and get our gear more, well, easier to handle, more compact and more lightweight. So what other questions do we have here at the moment? Greetings from Canada, Peter Mazur. Greetings to Canada. So yes, definitely a video on the 2M setup.
Well, we just did that.
Yeah, okay. Is it possible to put the Silver Edition into the MX? Yeah, at a certain point, sure. When I'm bored, I put everything in there, but I'm not bored yet. So we start with something. We will start with our main current products, and then let's see what, over the time, we will get into these amps and these amps and these effects and whatnot. So this is my hobby for the next 10 years, to feed the AMP-X. Okie doke, if you don't have any questions at this point, fair enough. Stay visiting the BluGuitar website for questions, because it's an intelligent knowledge base, which means you will find all the articles that come, that show up if you put in the search bar something like MIDI.
Use the search bar. That's the thing. If you have any kind of question, use the search bar. You are very likely to find what you're looking for. And if you don't, there's a contact us button. Click on it and let us know what's missing or what question you have. But use the search bar. There's a very intelligent search structure behind it, and it's fun using it, actually. I do it myself because I don't remember everything that I wrote down there.
Yeah, so. I mean, we had to do this before starting because the MS3 has a function that we both forgot, and even Kai, who owns this and programmed it, forgot it.
I programmed those sounds like 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And I totally forgot about it. I used BluGuitar to find out how to program patches and make the video work, the MIDI work on this one. So I tapped it in, read the article, and there it was.
Yeah. And this is the whole concept about this knowledge base. It's, you know, at a certain point, I will forget about some functionalities of AMP1 and all, you know, because I move on with AMP-X and where's the knowledge? And this should not disappear. On the social media, like Facebook, there's a timeline. And if there's a beautiful article there, it will be gone in the next week. Nobody scrolls down 2 years and sees that. And this is what we are doing on our knowledge base. We kind of put it there and make it easy accessible with the search bar. And we want to get your feedback and grow this knowledge base. So we have an easy way to give fast answer. And this is BluGuitar. It's alive. And the more questions you you will find, and the more people that use it, we can also monitor what is being used, what people ask for. We can care in a better way for you.
Yeah.
This is why we are doing that. So if you do have any more requests, write them here in the comments or visit there. There's a contact button. Let us know what you want to know. I think it's time for the next section of this episode, which is my very dear friend, Ali Neander. Ali was my hero when I was a teenager. I have to admit, I'm maybe 17, I went to his concerts, and he was the real deal rocker. He was on stage playing his Rio Grande or Marshall amps, Roy from Thomas Reusenzin, Frankfurt amp designer who passed away recently of cancer. But Ali, he had that tone, and he was, no prisoners, killer player, killer tone, always big fan of Ali Neander. So finally, we both grow a bit older, and I subbed for him because he had double bookings and stuff. So this was how I got a little bit into his world. And then we played in bands together for a short period of time with two guitar players. So I was always very happy to have something to do with Ali and trade licks and whatnot. And the other day, we talked about pedal platforms, like, okay, Fender amps is here, my good old Princeton, or Super Reverb. These are traditional pedal platform amps, which usually are clean and pristine clean, so they can show all the nuances of pedals. And Marshalls mainly have the reputation of being just a Marshall. But that's not true. A Marshall, even if it's dirty, can be tweaked with all the pedals. That's a classic. You have a Tube Screamer, or you have an OD1, or you have, any Rangemaster booster or SD1, or that all creates killer tones. But on the other hand, you can also set up a Marshall a little cleaner and use it as a pedal platform amp, and it works beautifully. There have always been people doing that. It's just not as obvious. And the main reason for that is most people looking at Marshall believe that the Marshall is the 100% tone as it is cranked, because if you crank a Marshall, it makes the rock and roll bark. Okay, and what else do you need? Do you need any pedal for that? Not really. But just dial back a little bit of that gain, get it to the clean range, and you have a beautiful pedal platform. And you can go in between the pristine style cleans and slight dirt. I like the slight dirt always. And then put a pedal on top of that. So for me, it's a pedal platform, and it always has been a pedal platform. In my world, the Marshall was slightly dirty, and then the pedals on top. But you can get it exactly like a Fender, clean as well. And this is what we are talking in the next section here, which is another hour. You have to watch this because of Ali. So anyway, enjoy, and we will see us again next week, same time, same place. Thanks, Kai, for joining in.
Thanks for having me.
And now over to Ali and myself. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, welcome back, Mr. Ali Neander, the one and only, the German guitar icon, and Mr. I would say, for me, he was one of the first guys that I saw playing proper Marshalls and proper
volume.
And proper volume, yeah. I've been a big fan when Ali played in my teenage days. I watched him in, I think, Völklingen or with Rodger Monoton.
St. Wendel.
Or St. Wendel.
This is, for the folks at home, this is Saarland. This is very special.
Yeah.
People party very hard, and they always had festivals and still have festivals, and you better be good in Saarland.
Yeah. <know. laughs> Yeah. So today's topic is Marshall as a pedal platform. And I kind of like to use the opportunity to have somebody that has played Marshalls probably more than most of you guys.
What?
Yeah. No. And louder than you guys. So this is the proof.
No, I've spent a considerable time of my life in front of a Marshall.
Yeah.
Is it good? Is it bad? I don't know. Well.
Yeah. Well, it is good.
Yeah,
it is good. It must be good because you did it.
I survived.
Yeah. And Ali has a good taste, and therefore, it must be good. Let's maybe analyze a little bit where we're coming from. So, you know, there's rock bands, there are our icons. We heard, you know, Eric Clapton, Jimmy Page, Ritchie Blackmore, you know, all those great rock guitar players with their Marshall wall. But how did they create the sound? Different ways. You know, my heroes, well, maybe yours too, Ritchie, started with something like that, a Range Master, which has then later been an Ivar reel-to-reel thing, which Bernd Meiser did in this little nice pedal format, very usable, not the Ivar tape machine. So this is the treble booster option.
Yeah.
But having Ali here, I would like to understand your cooking recipes when it comes to a Marshall. I mean,
originally, I come from the Clapton Cream School. That is actually no pedal. It's like a stack dimed, you know, basically. Yeah. Which, of course, under today's circumstances, there are bootlegs on YouTube of very early Cream gigs in clubs with like maybe 150 people. And you can hear two Marshall stacks being dimed. I mean, people survived that.
Yeah. Well, this was the 60s.
Yeah.
Today you would have a big...
lawsuits. It would be all lawsuits.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway. So this was... But of course you cannot do this in real life. So,
yeah.
So
not anymore.
So, not anymore. And real back then, not really anymore, yeah. Too. And that's why Marshall invented the master... Or master volume was invented by somebody else, but eventually...
Used the master.
But Marshall, in the mid-70s, introduced it to their amplifiers, and that made it possible for us mortals
to use Marshalls on stage in a considerable distortion by itself.
Yeah.
Like the first actual pedal platform player that I know of is Jimi Hendrix, because he played a clean Marshall basically, and then had a Roger Mayer Fuzz Phaser or whatever in front of it.
Yeah.
And so because that was a possibility to have a good clean sound in the first place, and then
Dirty sound,
fuzz. Fuzzes create very good clean sounds anyway, because they, when you turn them down, they get so very beautifully clean.
Yeah, maybe I give you my jack, and I switch you onto my GTM 45, so we can hear what you're talking about. This might get loud. Are you? It's the wrong amp. Just to prove you guys, this is the socket for this gentleman here. Treble input, which I dime.
Okay.
Yeah. This is what it.
Yeah, you could
straight in.
I mean, now there's some kind of a treble bleed in the guitar, so it's today one would. And it was kind of hard. If you turned the Stratocaster down on a Marshall, it would get kind of dull. And that would then, when the fuzzes pedals came in, because fuzzes, because of the reaction of the germanium transistors and all of the wiring it all together, clean up very nicely. And
it's up much nicer. So this is my Jimi Hendrix. Fuzz face. I mean, a Dunlop recreation, but it's the same circuitry.
The circuitry is kind of simple. You nerds out there, you've seen all the fuzz YouTube things. There's a whole science around it, but it's basically a rather simple circuitry.
Let's try and get this going for a second. I plug this in here, you plug the guitar in here, and I make this. Oh, sorry. Box. This is the fuzz on, and the guitar is down. It's really low. So this,
typical thing, we want to show you something and it doesn't work. Anyway, but because the fuzzes react differently, and
this is probably.
Interesting thing about fuzzes is that the volume knob does the sound changes every millimeter. It's incredible. And this doesn't clean up that extremely. But anyway, maybe we have another one. That we'll show it. But you get the
picture.
You get the picture.
So this was maybe let's be quick about this. Here's another classic, which is the Tube Screamer. And this is the input.
And the Tube Screamer is kind of it was used as a sort of antidote to some of the early master volume Marshalls, like JCM at 800s, that have had kind of a mid-rangey, very edgy sound at times. And people brought the Tube Screamer in to control the bass, first of all, because it cuts the bass, and to add some pleasant bits.
Yeah. So, you know what, I have to, let me modify my setup here for a second. So, okay, here we go.
Thank you. It has this certain kind of mid-range thing. And I think the JTM 45 is not the
best one.
It's about these Marshalls that had like these really fluffy big bass and a kind of edgy high mid. And this sort of
rounds it up.
Yeah.
You know, put something in the middle where there is nothing, where there is kind of this groups mid.
And a lot of like metal guys use that too, because to get this specific mid range in front of rectifier. So
yeah. Let's see how we get with this Chula here, which is another one that I like sometimes, just for fun.
Maybe turn the JTM a little down, lower, so we have kind of a slight crunch, yeah? Add some meat.
Yeah, you know? It is. I prefer this one to the Tube Screamer because that amp already has the mids.
Yeah.
So you know, as this amp doesn't need any extra frequency correction, a more flat boost like this one sounds better to me.
Yeah, yeah, but this is a religious thing. There are people out there that love Tube Screamers, and I don't want to say anything against them, but I'm the same. I'm not of this ballpark of the camp.
Yeah. Okay, this is a homemade thing that offers a few different settings.
Oh, let me see. Today is called transparent overdrive.
Yeah. Okay. I got this 10 years ago. Anyway, and this is it's like a two-stage thing where we.
These things in front of Marshalls. Marshalls have this one sound in the end, how you dial it in, and then it's about versatility, about like getting more out of a Marshall, make it more practicable.
It makes some other noise, which makes it flexible. Ah, by the way, we have a tube one. I don't find my power supply for this one here, but you probably know that's the Max Röhrig, and there's the, what is the other one called? The
Daniel D.
Daniel D.
Thomas, I think we talked about him in the last show. Yeah. Sadly, he died a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
He was the MacGyver of tube amps. You came up with all these ingenious ideas, you know, boosters and preamps and blah, 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 and amp mods. And this was one of his creations, and sadly he's not with us anymore. Yeah.
It's a very good sounding pedal. Yeah. Technically, it's a cathode follower stage of a Marshall or Fender. Mm-hmm. It's a classic design, which gives you the second harmonic as good as it gets from a real tube. Basic design, but it sounds killer. I have this on my board, and I used it for ages. So that's another classic from my board part. Hey, you know, then there's the Red, which goes with anything, and so on.
I mean, it goes. Reds have, it's always Marshalls and Reds have a, it's kind of a marriage also. They're very specific, especially in the punk era.
Yeah.
There were a lot of very defined sounds of normal, like JCM 800s that were kind of merciless anyway in the first place. And then here comes the Red, and then it's sort of
over the top.
It's you know the thing.
Yeah, and technically speaking, the Red has an operational amplifier, an op amp, and this op amp is clipping besides the diodes, and the op amp, it gives you this extra hard clip, which is a thing that you usually don't get from the tube amps. So this gives you the edge.
Yeah.
The modern, so the Red is kind of, ooh, what's that, you know, when it came out. Okie doke, maybe we can switch to your pedal selection and maybe on my cleaner, Marshall, which is number 4, but you have to plug into here. We kind of have too many options here, but...
Okay, now what I have here, it has become, and I had this for 20 years now, and it has become, since... Oh. It's not an Odi, it's a Nobles ODRS, which is not an old Nobles Audio 1, which has become a very desirable, the vintage ones at least, although the new ones are pretty much the same. because of Tombuco Vec and so on. But I've this one for 20 years, and it has a, it's a little different from the designs made by the same guy, and. It has a 3-band EQ, which is kind of interesting when you wanna, you know, try to, you know, this, like, this is the guitar without the pedal.
One sec. Just to explain the guys, we are using my Thomas amp, which is behind Ali. This is a Black Flag GTM.
Yeah.
And now we are using the unmodded PA channel. So okay. This is... just for the reference.
So this is like this
should, clean.
It's like when this guitar has been used quite a lot, I guess. But let us imagine ourselves in 68 or from when this is from.
This is 68.
It's 68. So if you plug the guitar in, it sounds like this. No, the Nobles does the following. It's a overdrive. Use the controls to match the clean sound in the basic frequency area. So the same bass. And so you don't, it's not like with a tube screamer that the frequency
shift.
Range is shifting completely, but if you work a little bit, it's not like really sophisticated, but you get the thing done, and then you have then the clean sound or the crunch sound and the mid gain or whatever you want to call it are in the same frequency range. And that makes it for me very usable for me because I don't, you know, it's not like what is this, it's just a little more distorted.
I think that's the general approach on Nobles.
I kind of like the bass. A lot of people turn down the bass on overdrives, but I, you know, it's like for grown-ups.
Yeah, I'm also a fan of big tones. You know, low end is makes authority.
Yeah. No, I mean in this case, because you have a clean sound, you can use. It sounds kind of. Out of tune anyway, but you get it. You get this sort of big bass, which still has enough treble on top and everything.
Give me the cable for a sec. Let me see. So, okay. Same pedal, whereas mine.
They kind of. You could, like 2 years ago, you could get them for €40, And now they're like 900 or something.
Really? Yeah, on Reverb America.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Because they are nobles. They are nobles.
They're very noble. No, yeah. I mean, it's like it's this thing. People are having too much time at home because of COVID, watching famous guitar players showing pedals. I mean, this is this is poisonous in a way. But you know, for me, I have three of them.
So this is your settings, which is quite interesting. Yeah. So you have the gain at whatever 9 o'clock.
It's almost. I mean, they have.
How I use it. I use it like on 2 o'clock sometimes. Yeah. This is my last setting here. Yeah. Maybe it's...
You can use it as a distortion pedal, which is absolutely fine. And I have one built in a bigger enclosure where I have two pairs of gain and level.
Ah, okay.
It's like a little Voisin amp in a... In a pedal thing, so I can switch. I could have put like two pedals in it. I'm stupid, but I wanted to make it complicated.
Yeah. And this is your setting, okay?
No, this is how I used it on tour. But this was in front. This is like not. It was not with a Marshall, but you can do it with Marshall. That's a great thing because you can sort of dial it in so it works well with how Marshalls react, and they totally react differently from Fenders. Or Vox or something, you know. This amplifier is on -1. It's like almost not on. That's the interesting thing about like plexis. Yeah. You can dial in like a really clean sound that is a bold, clean sound, and then do everything in front of them. Including reverb, including delays and everything. I played in a funk band with a 100-watt plexi and a 112 cabinet, and it was all clean. I played a Gretsch, all clean, and it was great. It was heavy. That's the only problem, really. But it was really great, and I recommend people to try out because. Not only to always put it in the treble input of like, but also experiment, put in the low input, bridge over to the treble input, add a little treble, you get almost like a Fenderish big clean sound out of it.
Marshalls are underestimated when it comes to clean.
But you know, since nobody wants to carry them around, give them to me.
Okay, what's the next secret weapon?
Well, another one that this is not an original pedal. It's a replica of a Maestro full range booster. Now, what is this? It's one of the like earliest pedals ever. It was at the same time, it's somewhere in the 60s. It's when Tom Oberheim, the synthesizer designer, did a lot of pedal designs for Maestro. And this was one, and I show you. This is a four band boost thing with a little very simple fuzz circuit.
Okay, I plug you in.
Yeah.
So this is
this is off. Like low mids. Mids. Bass off, so you can. And then there's this fuzz circuit. It's very simple, but and this is one of the things that is always the same thing. It very much comes to taste with pedals. How designers choose their parts. I think it's very tasteful. The choice of frequencies and and this fuzz circuit, and it's really a usable little pedal that does a lot of things, especially when amps are kind of strange in the input, maybe a little mushy, not tight enough, then you turn down the bass in, but give it a little mid push. And so I saw it and I asked, and the schematics are online. You can use it. Simple, basically, yeah. Very simple. But it does the job, especially when you have these sort of neurotic Marshalls sometimes. And Marshalls are all different. I mean, yeah, this is...
There's not a single Marshall that is like the same.
Yeah, it's. I mean, normally one would think, and it's without, like, with a Mesa Boogie sounds like a Mesa Boogie,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
But when we have maybe four Marshalls from the same period,
they are all different.
They're extremely different. And yeah. I mean, maybe the parts were, I don't know what it was. Tolerance. But it's great because it's almost like persons.
Yes, sure. Okay, let me hear again this pedal on like your favorite setting.
Well,
just do one.
It would make sense if I paired it maybe in front of a drive pedal too. But just to show you, you know, it's... There's too much high mid sound, and you turn it down. Turn down the bar. It gets bigger. Very musical. That's what I like about it.
I would like to check that against my clean channel on the amp1. Just leave it on.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
And I switch to the amp1. Can you play? And can you play? Okay, sorry, no. We have to plug the guitar into the switcher.
And then oh.
Yeah, okay. Otherwise it does not work.
No problem.
So this go here. But now you need the cable from the Marshall. No.
Yeah.
which one is it? There must be a cable. Ah, here, this one. This cable could... No.
True wizardry.
Is it the one... And where's this cable going to? No, this is the cable you have in the hand.
Yeah.
No. Wait a minute. I'm getting confused here. There must be another cable which we had... Wait a minute. Where's this cable going to? Oh, this was the pedal. Sorry.
No problem.
Ah, Ali, I can see it. See the cable on the floor with the red thing. That needs to go into the Marshall. Yes, we get this off because this is now... Okay, and now you're plugged in here. And this... where's this? This go... No,
that goes into the switching.
Wait a minute, no. This cable goes into... this other end. So I know. So we want the pedal in front of the Marshall. So this goes into the Marshall.
Yeah, but it's
yeah. And the other, which the cable you put in the Marshall goes into the pedal. I hold it for a second. Yeah. Flip this. Give this to me. Okay. And now we are talking. So.
Ah, I hear something.
That's the Marshall. Let's check.
There's one cable down here.
No, it's okay.
Well, that was the M1 then.
No, this was the other Marshall. Okay. Wait a minute. Guitar goes into here. This is this Marshall.
For comparison, it's just as good, isn't it? Just for experiment. Turn it down a little bit, maybe the JTM.
No. What did we do? Anyway, so this goes into... where's this thing going? I have to start from scratch. Wait a minute, this cable is this M1 that we played at the beginning. Okay, fine. So, and this one is the cable in, out. And the out goes into
The switch, the Marshall. It goes into the Marshall.
This is wrong because I need to get this, because we are now on the other Marshall, you know? We this has to go here. No, because we have, we cannot fake it. The thing, okay, slowly. Let me explain to everybody. What's going on is we have a switcher with four systems. This is AMP1, and that's working. I can prove reverb. Okay, nice.
Okay, that's good.
So, two is the Iridium, which is this one. Okay, we have this one. So, three is this amp here. Okay. But, so, how to get this pedal in between that? And four was the other Marshall. And I want to get the other Marshall going on first, because then we are back to normal. And this means we have to get... Okay, speakers in. We have to get a cable into the Marshall that makes sounds now. Try the in from this one. This into the Marshall. Into this PA Marshall. So if we have sound, so there, play. Now
the out
goes into the Marshall again.
Yeah.
And if that's the, now it has to work. If that doesn't work, I quit.
We go into a bar.
Yeah.
And get pissed.
It works.
So, okay. This is troubleshooting.
Yeah.
If there's a trouble, start from scratch, you know, rethink. Okay, now we are back on the block.
Very good.
So, we had this, but...
You wanted to check out the clean sound?
Yeah. So, now I understand my mistake, and we still haven't done it, because we have to put the pedal in between the guitar and the switcher. So, this has to go back into the Marshall. So, okay, this goes back into the Marshall, this goes into the pedal, and the Marshall comes into the switcher. Okay, trust me, I know what I'm doing. This is ein Knoten. Oh, this is so. Da da da. So.
Yeah!
Okay. Let's see, that's the magic pedal here. No pedal. Okay, so now I can switch to the other M. For me, what I wanted to show is that is a beautiful pedal with this Marshall, but it also works on the clean channel of AMP1 because we can get close and then happy days.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
That's
back to the Marshall.
Yep. No, the idea is that you have a clean sound that has a certain kind of a character, whether it's a Marshall or whether it's a Fender or the M1, which has a known character, you know?
Yeah.
And that's the great thing, what I find about M1 is it does not pretend to be everything, but it's very versatile because it decides on certain things and you have ways to arrange to what to dial in, and that gives it a character, but also makes it very, you know, very usable as a Marshall or a Vox or a Fender or whatever it is. You find your way around, you twiddle the knobs. You know.
One more thing I would like to check is the fuzz. Is the fuzz working with the Marshall? We are on the Marshall now. Mm-hmm. And see how that sounds. Mm-hmm.
that, what I like about this fuzz is that it cleans up nicely.
Yeah. Yeah, but tasty pedal. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm impressed about the choice of frequencies and...
Yeah, Tom Hoberheim made, there's the famous Maestro Fuzz, of course, which is the satisfaction fuzz.
Yeah.
But the other, he has a phase, there's a phase shifter, which to me is, I mean, it sucks very much the signal. It's very large, but to me it's still the most beautiful sounding phaser because it's very smooth and beautiful and doesn't have like this wobbly stuff, you know.
I heard that this company is back on the block.
Yeah, they have issued a whole range of new pedals, and I hope they do that one too because this is a classic it was because of one of my heroes, Bill Connors, guitarist with Chicoria in the early 70s.
Fusion player
who had a great rock sound. Yeah. A lot of fusion players don't have that much. But I saw him live. He played a Marshall Major.
200 watts.
And a Les Paul Custom. Yeah. I wouldn't say it was not Ramon's position, but it was definitely not like this.
Yeah.
No Hank Marvin. And he played the phase shifter, and he played that.
Yeah.
And it sounded awesome. It sounded big.
Yeah.
And I didn't know about this. I only read this like 30 years later. Mm-hmm. And I asked a friend of mine, can you build me one of those? Because they are sometimes they're on in the internet, but they are like $400 and, you know.
No. Too much for...
I'm not a collector. And they have... Yeah. The switches are kind of... They look like they immediately break.
Yeah. A friend built a one that is usable.
Yeah, that's usable. It has survived, as you can see. It has survived. it's roadworthy, so I'm happy. I have a second one. But the thing is, with these, since the parts are... It's not a lot of parts in this, so every pedal sounds different. But that one I really like.
I like it too. Mm. Okay, what's the next secret weapon when we talk about Marshall and pedals as a pedal platform? Maybe this one.
Yeah, this is. I mean, there's been a lot about clones in the last couple of years. I think clones were originally designed to be played in front of Fender amps to make them sound bigger and to sort of make them cut through the mix a little better, which was my first introduction to this in the early 2000s. I saw the band of Bilal, famous soul singer, and there was a guitarist who had only a rental twin, an analog delay, and a clone. Mm-hmm. And it's not that it was like the greatest sound in the world, but it set so perfectly in the mix that I said, well, this is something. This is not just a Fender amp. It does something. It puts it on the right spot.
It idealizes the Fender. Yeah. It's the glory, the Fender glory by two.
but the problem with, first of all, there's thousands of clones out there. And even two old clones don't sound the same. Yeah. And it's a complete nerdy mystery thing going on.
And the prices are bullshit.
It's totally ridiculous for just a couple of parts, electronic parts.
Yeah.
So I tried a lot of those, and they're all in a way good, like the one that Bill Finnegan, the original creator, made.
Yeah.
It's a red one, it's called KTR.
Yeah.
It's all good. It's
it's very similar.
And since he's the guy, you know, it's only fair. This is by Rocket, American brand, and it has an added EQ, and that's what I like, because a clone makes a certain kind of mid-range noise, and if you don't like it exactly like the way it is,
you can tweak it here.
It's good to have some kind of possibility to... Same with the notes. I mean, it's basically the same thing. You can do. It's not about dramatic changes. It's just about getting things a little more to your liking.
Wasn't this also used by Steve Stevens.
Could be, yeah.
I think I saw it with Steve Stevens on the pedal board.
It's basic. I can show you. Yeah. It's a clone, or you know,
a flexible clone.
There's
flexi clone.
There's nerds out there that would immediately say, "Nah, it's not a real clone." But
output, So wait a minute. I plug in here.
Let's see. So back to the. A clean sound.
Yeah, Marshall is back on the.
And you know, this is just, I have it dialed in a little bit of the, you know, a clone is kind of a booster that blends in a overdrive. That's basically what it is. You see, there's a mid-range thing, which when you have like a very clean big fin ramp with a lot of bass, it does the right thing. But in this case, it's not that helpful.
Yeah.
So. You know, it's just this, you know, you just do little things. Maybe add a little treble, high mids lower, you know, it's to their taste.
Yeah.
And then you can, with, you know, add more distortion, less distortion, whatever you want. And then you get in the ballpark where you want to be.
Yeah.
And instead of, oh, this is not the right pedal, I have to buy a new one. This is why I like this kind of flexibility.
Mm-hmm.
I might sacrifice some of the real...
authentic clone.
Fairy
clone,
dust.
Who cares?
I don't care.
Yeah.
so that is very usable. It seems to be like there seems to be a pattern here. This is a treble booster where you can dial in how much bass cut off you want, which is the same thing for me.
Mm-hmm.
Or EQ.
Yeah.
This is a modded boss EQ. Very good to have it modded because it gets the whole noise ratio is much better.
Yeah,
it gets more musical and it's not as compressing.
Mm-hmm.
It's really very usable, but it's always the same thing. The amp itself is a great platform, but you can maneuver yourself into the area where you really like it.
Yeah. I have done similar things. Just for now, can you give me that little? I just stick your cable.
Sure.
Mm. So, and then see. Let's like.
The issue. So,
yeah. Just for let me do something on. I have an idea. The low gain mode. Do we have a remote? Remote. Here's a remote. Okay. Okay. Sorry. I have an idea. So guys, I'm doing the vintage channel bypass. We are on the vintage channel. Mm-hmm. Let me create a sound that I have in my head and use this as the optimizer.
Yeah.
That's the AMP1 as it is, but it has way too much gain. Therefore, I'm using the second gain and get rid of all my gain. So this is now the vintage channel. gain full here, but gain minimum here. Now I use that pedal to tweak it, and I can hear in my head already how great that sounds. Get rid of the reverb or have less. So, well, today we're. Kind of a boogie thing to have just one little frequency going. Yeah, I couldn't get this with my amp alone. You know, this is it's a nice tweaker. I would call this a nice tweaking pedal. I like.
Yeah, this is, it seems that I'm gravitating towards those kind of pedals because, you know. Us old farts, as I have to say, we always gravitate to the same sound anyway. So we have pedals and we get this.
In the end, we sound the same.
But
we call this style. I mean, you know, it's like Carlos Santana.
Is it a style or is it just a bad manner?
Well, you know, focus the mids and go. On the Marshall, no. Yeah. I need the AMP1. I need my. I have no sound. Why? I have to plug in the cable. Back to basics. I give you. What's your next pedal?
Well, it's not very common to use compressors in front of Marshall, but it does do something.
Let's check that out. You plug this in here. Yeah. You plug it in here. I switched back to the Marshall.
We are
totally first authentic. Marshall.
So this is
okay. Wait a minute. Back to the clean.
It's a very simple concept. It has a volume knob and a sustain knob. Pedal if you want, but it's good if you have, if you really want, like, it's
kind of edgy, you know, and it's big, and it reacts, it compresses, as it's, that's what it's good for. It's not like extremely country-esque. Good clean sound, you know, and a friend of mine told me, I have this on my board, I have it always on, and try it out. It's a simple one, but it does what it does, and it reacts fast enough. You try it.
I've just for fun, I have an MXR over here. I'm just curious.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
We can. Well, who cares? We don't need the power because there is a battery.
Oh, battery, okay.
Okay. And this is. I hope it works. Can we? Can you play?
Vintage, that's for sure.
Yeah, and I'm preferring the Coca Boost. Okay, just for fun, let me hear my yellow comp. And you know, I'm just interested in if Oko has a pedal that I have to buy now because I you know, this is a personal thing. Okay, how is this? This is my personal favorite boost so far. When the camera shows it,
compressor.
Diamond compressor. It's also music, but the Coca. I'm going back for the Coca. I have to say, it's guitar input and output and power. Very musical pedal. Oh, sorry.
we're the. This is the Buster Keaton show of
pedal man. Yeah,
I'm fine.
Yeah, okay, here we go. Let's hear that. Sorry, I like it. I like it very. Is the compressor of the day, okay? You know, I mean, we have a clean tone, we have that pedal, and it's a good match. But this is what the show is about today. But this is my personal moment, okay? Yeah, I want one of those. Okay, next, before I buy... Is there anything left on your table, or...?
It was only the... This is a dumbbell type overdrive. I can show you that sometimes it makes sense to have it. Normally, normally you would think this is nothing in front of a Marshall, but since this,
I give you the cable so you explain what you're doing with it.
Yeah.
Okay. Here we go.
But here we are back again on the merciless dry Marshall. And you hear it immediately. It's there's a certain mid range. A little bit what the Rockaway did with the EQ turned up. It's a very specific
mid-range.
Type of mid range sound that when you dial it up a little more, it gets a very pleasing sort of vocal thing, and then when you have more Marshall-y overdrives, there's more crunch, and then you get this sort of thing that does this very well because it cleans up also nicely. It doesn't show, but anyway. Anyway,
I have a quick go on my guitar.
Yeah, sure, because
This is mine is a super cleaner.
Yeah.
Let's see that. Okay, let me see what I can do with the M1 on this pedal. Yeah, I like this mid honk boost into my boost into my clean channel. This is kind of gain stacking.
Yeah,
but a nice one.
Josh Army from Queens of the Stone Age.
Yeah.
They make their distorted sounds just with mid boosts. Like one mid boost
after the next other. And the next. Yeah, and this. Is there,
yeah,
you know,
it's like a 500 hertz something
and vocalist
which kind of sits
at the right
in the mix
in the perfect
if you want it there, you know.
Sure, but it all makes sense
and it's well done, and you know, sadly he is not doing them anymore.
Yeah, so I have one more pedal from my side which we showed on some other episode, but I think that's a good one to show when it comes to the Marshall story, which is the Solo Dalla Storm, based on the famous
Sheffer
wireless system that the Young Brothers of AC/DC have been using. Mm-hmm. So, wait a minute, this is guitar. I have the guitar. That's the amp. And as we can hear, there is a battery in there. And I'm plugged in. Just hold.
Yeah,
so
sure.
This is like that's my M1.
M1, yeah.
Let's go back for the Marshall then first. Okay, we had a lot of boost.
But that this is if you get something out of the sound like that, you get a sound out of everything.
Okay. Put it. Level and basically that's a for me everything sits at the right spot. It's compression amount.
It's kind of a mixture of a booster and a compressor.
Yeah,
and It does. I think it's the lesson we learned tonight is that it's the taste of the designer that they choose a musical, you know, musical parts, or they actually listen to their stuff and not just
solder some shit,
solder parts together.
What you want to play?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. It's a nice one.
Switch to the M1.
M1? Okay, wait a minute. M1, it's too much gain now. killer combination. Mm-hmm. I like the pedal. So we learned there are different pedals from different manufacturers, from different, well, designers, artists, and they give you a color that you probably don't have in your palette now. And yeah, we heard Ali's choices. I've seen some of the pedals on your pedal boards over the years in any combination, you know, with your AMP1 and your Marshall and whatnot.
It's always the same thing. I mean, notoriously, us guitarists have too many pedals and pedals come and go. But it seems that the ones stay that offer a certain kind of possibility of the first, and then they find that spot, which frequency wise at least pleases my ear or our ear.
Mine too.
That it's not about extreme. I mean, of course, there's great pedals that do extreme stuff. We are very much in the kind of a friendly blues rocky territory. So this is a small area, but going from there, it's always good to have some kind of a good basic sound. And that's what I think we are trying to achieve. Something that where the guitar, this is my guitar. And then you could dial in any kind of freakish stuff.
Exactly. You know? And so we heard it today with a clean Marshall. And this is kind of the Marshall as a pedal platform. This was what we've done today. I sometimes had Marshalls cranked like my GTM 45 with a little gain, get it clean with the guitar, roll down the volume, and have pedals additionally.
Yeah, that's
another nice.
It's like also a Vox AC30 can be used like that. Like all the early Deep Purple is AC30 range masters into AC30s.
Yeah, you know? And sounds killer.
And this is a very a classic combination, but these kind of Marshalls, all the big ones, all the big ones. Another guy who uses Marshalls that way is Eric Johnson.
Yeah,
I mean,
sure.
He has the tube driver, and then it goes into, it's like a little, it's turned, it's in a breakup maybe, it at breakup, and that's the whole sound.
Yeah. Cool, I think that's it. Shall we play a few notes for the outro? But you are plugged in this amp. Can I plug into yours then?
Yeah, sure.
Wait a minute. So where's the cable? Thank you. Hey, thank you so much, Ali Neander.
Thank you for having me. Yeah.
And we finally played two AMP1s, but I played yours and you played mine. Okay. Who cares? It sounded good. There's many ways. Yeah. Thanks, Ali. See you again.
Thank you.
Check out Ali Neander on his website and all his records. We have a special episode, which is episode 96, where we show him as an artist in the full length. See you guys.